Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us today on TomTech Academy. My name is Doug Bito. I am a cardiac sonographer and clinical application specialist with TomTech Imaging. Today we will be focusing on a very important topic, strain standardization. Joining us is Bernhard Mom, president of TomTech Imaging. As always, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Mr. Mom as our guest speaker, and of course, thank each of you for joining us.
So thank you very much, Doug, for your nice introduction. And hello, everybody. Welcome to this TomTech webinar on strain standardization. And we are very happy that we have a record number of participants for this webinar. Probably we will reach around 100 people from around the world. We have participants from Asia Pacific and from Middle East, from Europe, of course. And good morning to everybody from the Americas, from Brazil, United States, and from Canada. So it's really a worldwide webinar, and the big number of participants shows this importance of the topic strain standardization and strain overall. And it seems that this is an interesting topic, how to get strain to the clinical routine. So let me give you an overview about what you would like to hear and see in the webinar for the next 25-30 minutes. First of all, I would like to start with an overall introduction to strain, what it is, and strain quantification, talking about the methods and the problems we had in the past or we had so far. And then second, I would like to focus on the goals and objectives of the so-called strain task force. Officially, it's called the task force to standardize deformation imaging, and its latest status and achievements and the latest publications we have right now. And then third, at the end, I would like to give you a brief overview about TomTech's strain solutions, not only in the field of 2D echocardiography, but as well for 3D strain. So let's move on to the first point, introduction to the strain quantification and the methods. And I guess a lot of most of you already aware what strain is, but to start easy, I would like to repeat it. So strain more or less is very simple. It's the deformation or the lengthening of a myocardial fiber or a muscle fiber. And on this example, you see the delta of the length of the fiber between its original length, L0, and the extended or shrinked length divided by the original length is the strain. The strain rate basically is then only the strain, the change of strain over time. So far it's quite simple. And let me show it to you here at the example of this sample, a microscopic video of a contracting muscle fiber. And sorry, it's due to the webinar bandwidth, it's not beating so nicely like on my notebook here, but it shows us how a muscle is contracting. And it's contracting from its extended length to a shrinked length. And here in this example, in this sample, we have a 15% shortening. And shortening means it's a negative strain. So if we would call that global longitudinal strain, we would have a minus 15% GLS. How does this apply to the heart and the myocardium? And here, on the right side, you see now a symbolized heartbeat, left ventricle, and the longitudinal strain, so the myocardium is shortening throughout the cardiac cycle, and that's why, like in the sample you've seen before, we have a negative strain. This is different if we look to the radial strain. Here, same like in this sample of the muscle before, the myocardium is thickening, so we talk about a positive strain here. The strain, most of the time today, it's quantified and evaluated based on speckle tracking, but it was started already last millennium, 1998. Strain range imaging was introduced based on tissue Doppler. However, we all know that tissue Doppler had a lot of limitations, this angle dependency and so on, so a better technique got introduced 2004, speckle tracking based, 2D speckle tracking based at this time, and then 4 years later, in the year of 2008, we introduced then the first 3D spectral tracking product and technology. But how does spectral tracking work? And I would like to explain it to you based on this video, this animation. And again, the bandwidth is not so great that it's really smooth, but what you will see here is you have this pattern, a sample here, the head of this guy. And if I play the movie, you see that this pattern can follow the head of this guy, even if he's moving through the hall, the room, and even if there is noise in front of him. The noise in this case are this newspaper pieces which are moved around, but the software can track the head and can follow then the motion of this head. And more or less we do the same if we track the pattern in the myocardium. So here on the right side you see this head of the guy, but on the left side the sample of the myocardium, the speckled pattern taken out of the septum in this case, and we can now use speckle tracking techniques in order to follow the motion of this myocardium sample, this region of interest as we call it, throughout the cardiac cycle. This would then be applied not only in one sample but across the entire length of the endocardium as seen here in this four chamber view, and yellow arrows are now indicating and displaying the direction and the speed. The length of the arrow is the speed of the motion of this myocardial wall piece, and we can visualize it, but not only visualize it, we can quantify it as well based on speckle tracking. Let me just show you our latest technology to quantify global longitudinal strain based on three long axis views. So you see here four-chamber view on the upper left side, two-chamber view on the upper right side, and the three-chamber view on the lower left side. And just with three mouse clicks, the software can automatically quantify and analyze this based on speckle tracking, this global longitudinal strain. And I will show you to you a little later in my presentation how this works and how simple this can be done. But strain can be quantified, at least the global longitudinal strain can be quantified, it's very simple, just manually. And let me show it to you. You can draw a border, and this is now symbolized here at this phantom. On the left side you see a phantom of a end diastolic ventricle, on the right side the end systolic, and we just draw by hand this green contour, and we measure then the length of the contour, and we put that into our strain formula, you know, from the slides before, and take this measured length and multiply it with 100%, and we get this 24.3% strain. So far it's very simple. However, now the first problem occurs, and this is where to measure, and many manufacturers are or have done that in a different way. And at this phantom now, let me show you how important it is where we measure and the influence of the position of the trace. As I've shown you before, if we do the contour at the endocardium or subendocardial, we get this minus 24% of strain. With the same heart, the same myocardium, if we draw the contour mid-myocardial, we get a minus 18%, and if we would draw the contour outside at the epicardium, we get a strain of minus 13%. So this is nearly half of the strain of the endocardial strain, and this already nicely shows that it's very important that everybody is measuring at the same position, or at least is indicating where the measurement has been done. Otherwise you will get big differences, not because of the algorithms are wrong, but because we measure different things. So this was one problem, but we have other problems to solve. And as you've seen up to now, we have global strain parameters like the global longitudinal strain, circumferential strain, but as well many possibilities to measure regional strain. Not only longitudinal and circumferential, we can measure the radial strain as seen before. Then we have parameters called area strain from 3D, shear strain, Lagrangian strain, and in the literature you see other strain names like Eulerian strain, normal strain, principal strain, and then not only strain rate and displacement. And then on the other side, if we look to all the implementations on the ultrasound systems, the vendors are using different algorithms, and or at least have used different algorithms in the past. They average in different way. They use they measure at different positions, like endocardial or transmural or mid-myocardial. Then the segments are different, like a 16, 17, or 18 segment model with or without drift compensation. And already here you see strain was so simple, but with all these different names and different measurement possibilities, it becomes already a nightmare and quite complicated, which doesn't need to be like that. And if we look to the first consensus paper from the American Society of Echo and the European Association of Echo from 2011, they concluded that strain is a very important technique which can help to transform echocardiography overall from a subjective art to be a very objective diagnostic tool, because we can quantify with strain much more precisely and reproducibly. However, the problems you've seen before, if we don't agree where and how to measure and how to call the measurements, then we will get different results. So multicenter studies are needed in order to figure out what are norm values and so on. And on the other side, we need to standardize what we measure and how we measure, and this standardization needs to be done among all the ultrasound manufacturers and workstation providers like TomTech. So what is the solution for that? And the solution was that all the relevant actors decided to start an initiative to standardize so-called deformation imaging and to create a task force. And initially, this task force was founded by the European Association and the American Society of Echo, and a little later then the Japanese and the Korean Societies of Echocardiography joined, as well as all relevant industry partners in echocardiography, and the ultrasound companies and vendor-neutral workstation or software providers like TomTech. So this brings me now to the second point of this webinar, the objectives of the strain task force. So as the strain task force met the first time, pretty soon we came up with the conclusion that strain is unreliable, not because of the measurements and the algorithms, but due to this interventor variability, and that there is definitely no agreement what to measure, and how to call the measurement. And that this is probably the first thing the standardization group should do, to come up with an agreement how we should do it. So the overall objective of this so-called strain task force, or this task force to standardize deformation imaging, was to develop this academia industry consortium to come up with this consensus on this standard definitions, the nomenclature, and this how and where to measure for the speckle tracking parameters. Let me now summarize you the task force activities since the beginning around 2011 till 2015. And at each ASE and EuroEcho, the task force is meeting and is making good progress. And the first agreement was that we need to clarify the definitions and the defined in the nomenclature and this what and how. And then in parallel to that, we decided that it would be very important to have a kind of ground truth for strain, and that's why the Leuven group from Belgium, Jan de Hoog and Dr. Voigt, they developed for the task force very nice synthetic computer model, dynamic model of beating heart with defined strain, and all the vendors had then to measure the strain in a blinded way, and then it was compared, and you will see the details a little later. And then the third part, we said phantom tests are good, but this will not be the real world, and we need to do real clinical validation. And within 1 week, again in Leuven in Belgium, 62 patients and volunteers God's Kent at the same time by 7 different ultrasound systems, and then the analysis was done with all the 7 ultrasound systems and the vendor independent workstations like TomTech, and I will show you the results of this very nice study a little later. The last activity, which is still ongoing, which was started now beginning of this year, was not only to look at global longitudinal strain, but to look at the regional strain. And the same, the groups scanned a big number of patients with predefined well-known wall motion abnormalities. Then the ultrasound systems should show what they can measure based on regional strain, and if the ultrasound companies and the strain vendors can come up with the same results. The analysis is still in progress, and we are very keen to see the results. So the first conclusion of the strain task force was it would be very important not to solve all the problems at the same time, but to focus on the most important strain parameter, which is really the global longitudinal strain, GLS. And as all the ultrasound companies and vendors can measure GLS subendocardial, it was the agreement that every vendor should at least measure it subendocardial. They are free to measure at different positions, but at least the subendocardial measurement should be provided, and that the measurement of the GLS should be done exactly with this formula, and you have seen the formula already before. So there was a definition paper then published end of 2014. Let me show it to you here. It was published at the same time in the European Journal of Cardiovascular Imaging as well as in CHASE, called Definitions for a Common Standard for 2D Speckle Tracking. And this consensus document was now really defining where to measure, how to measure, at least what is the agreement, and everybody can do it in different way, but at least the minimum they need to measure as it is defined in this consensus document, and that we focus in the first step on the GLS, the global longitudinal strain. So then the phantom tests, which I described to you just before with the synthetic phantoms, this publication will come up very soon. So it's accepted for publication in the European Journal, and within the next weeks it will be then published in this journal. And let me just show you what has been done here. This is an example of this computer-generated strain phantom. And it's dynamic, and it has a defined strain ground truth based on a defined speckle pattern which are moving, and all the vendors had to measure in a blind way the ground truth. So we have not known what is the ground truth, and then the results have been compared, and not only on one phantom. The Leuven group, they made phantoms with different heart rates, like 70 beats per minute up to 150 beats per minute, in order to mimic, an example, stress or exercise echo examinations, and see then the impact of frame rate and temporal resolution on the results of speckle tracking. So the conclusions of this paper are very nice, and it showed already that if we agree where to measure and that everybody is measuring at the same position, we can already reduce the vendor discrepancy very nicely to relative errors below 10% and an intra-vendor reproducibility within 5%, which is much better than all other conventional echo parameters which are right now. And this is very important, because strain is always supposed to be very unreliable. Strain in this test has proven it's much more reliable than all other conventional echo parameters measured up to now. So the third point, then, this clinical validation study on global longitudinal strain, as said before, 62 patients, all scanned with the 7 different ultrasound systems, and this was just recently published in July 2015, or more or less you can download it as an article in press. You see it here. It's called head-to-head comparison of global longitudinal strain measurements among 9 different vendors. This includes the workstation vendors like TomTech. And here the conclusion as well is very promising. It says that the reproducibility of GLS, the global longitudinal strain, is good and in many cases really superior than all the conventional echo measurements like E2A or even EF or distances you measure. And therefore, the strain task was concluded that global longitudinal strain may be safely used in routine clinical practice. And of course, we still have small but significant variations among the vendors. And this should be considered if you plan a serial study. But as I will show you in one of the next slides, these variations will go down based on the agreements we have done in the strain task force, and we will come closer together with the strain measurements. So there was a very nice, huge amount of published data in the June Chase journal, because the journal was focused on LV strain. And I used Jim Thomas' editorial comments. He said, basically, in this journal, there are two sides how to look at strain problems and the strain situation. The first view we called the glass half empty view, and then the other view, the glass half full view. And for both views, you will find publications in this Chase journal. The first one by a Japanese group from Dr. Takeuchi, and he concluded that vendors are really converging, so the agreements are already much, much better than before, but still there is a large limit of agreement, and this remains a problem, and that therefore strain should be measured always with the same system. And the glass half full publication in the same Chase journal from Tom Marwick and Dr. Jim Thomas group concluded that the vendors are really converging, and that they compared older versions of the strain quantification to newer versions and concluded that based on the strain standardization initiative, now the values are already much better, much closer to each other than before. So that's a process which has been started with the strain initiative, and we are on the right way. And basically this half full view, you can read as well by the editorial comment by Dr. Jim Thomas, and he said as well, we are definitely moving in the right direction, and anyway, echo is by far the best modality for serial studies. So there's another recommendation paper for chamber quantification from the American Society of Echo and the European Association called Chamber Quantification Recommendations. And let me see what they say about strain. You will find in this recommendation that strain, especially GLS measurement, should be made in 3 standard apical views and averaged. And they talk even about normal GLS, which is between minus 18 and minus 20% for GLS. And that's exactly what we can do very easy with our latest TomTech AutoStrain solution. And I would like to show you how easily this can be done with our TomTech Arena software here. So I just opened this data set, and you see on the upper right a 4-chamber view, a 2-chamber view, a 3-chamber view, as I've showed you before. And now I just go into our 3-plane measurements here and select the automation icon here. And if this automation icon is selected, I just need to tell the software where is the 4-chamber view. So it's this one here. And then I move over to the 2-chamber view on this side here and just select the 2-chamber view. And then I move on to the 3-chamber view and just tell the software this is the 3-chamber view. I don't need to draw contours on nothing. And the software is automatically now detecting all the parameters, the contours here, and is giving us all the regional longitudinal strain parameters here in this bullseye view, or is giving us then the action fraction, the volumes, as well as the global longitudinal strain for these three apical views, and the averaged global longitudinal strain in the three-plane mode. With three clicks, you get it fully automatic and very reproducible based on this tracking technique. And you see this is not only in a static way, it's in a dynamic way. However, the motion is not so nicely shown here in this webinar bandwidth. So let me go back to my slideshow here. So as the time is limited, we cannot talk so much about the clinical usefulness of strain and speckle tracking echo, but just very broadly, it's very important for early detection of reduced myocardial function. An example, ischemic heart disease patients with myocardial variability assessment, cardiomyopathy patients, or as well to assess dyssynchrony in looking at this, the regional curve patterns. But very important, it's a very good tool to do serial examinations in cardio-oncology, because chemotherapy patients, quite often they have a preserved or normal ejection fraction, but significantly reduced function, left ventricular function, if assessed with speckle tracking. And this is a very important point. And finally, I'm not sure if you have this AEC open forum. Just 2 days, 3 days ago, I got this posting by a cardiac sonographer from the United States, and he claimed that they are playing around with strain imaging and that the literature looks impressive and, what he said, frightening. And he said frightening because of the correlation with cancer patients. And he stated then they had cancer patients that the strain dropped on the second echo after the chemotherapy started from baseline, even with preserved ejection fraction. So this shows how important strain speckle tracking can be for this group of patients. What are the next steps of the task force? The task force will now, as I showed you before, look at the regional strain. All the data have been already acquired this April, and the analysis is in progress. And the strain task force is then planning to look at 3D strain starting then next year. And 3D strain, why is it so important? And the answer you will see here on the next slide, it's that if we look at the speckle in 2D, it's only a kind of assumption because the speckle will move out of the plane. And if you watch this movie on the right side, it shows this single myocardial muscle band, which is wrapped around the ventricle and which is doing this twist and torsion. And there will never be the same speckle staying in one two-dimensional plane. They will move out of the plane. And this out-of-plane motion we can only assess based on 3D echo. And that's why we developed the 3D echo speckle tracking and strain measurements, where we can quantify then the 3D strain, or sometimes you call this principal tangential strain, out of the longitudinal and circumferential orientation, which more or less mimics then the fibrous orientations in the heart muscle. So this can be done very easily and quickly as well with our 4DLV analysis tool, just loading the 3D data set, and then the software automatically detects the left ventricle and is giving you a left ventricle beutel assumption, and based on this assumption, then the software more or less automatically calculates the 3D-based parameters like volumes, ejection, strain, twist, and displacement. So for sake of time, so that we have a little bit time for questions, I skipped these two examples here. Here you see a normal patient and the strain curves, and then on the next slide we would see then a patient with reduced left ventricular function very briefly. Here in the upper part you see this change color, and this indicates then the outward motion of the septal wall compared to the inward motion of the lateral wall. And of course, then the strain, the global longitudinal strain, was very much reduced. There are some nice latest publications on strain. I just like to mention them very briefly, and you can download this presentation and look at it a little bit more detailed. So this one is very nice, again, from the group from Dr. Takeuchi's validating the 3D strain quantification and defining norm values for different components of strain, and very important, looking at age-related differences in strain and trying to define age-related norm values for strain. And then very recently, again, a group from Dr. Takeuchi together with others, he showed the prognostic value of 3D speckle tracking, and that the 3D-based global longitudinal strain is the most robust index for this kind of patients for predicting cardiac events. So let me finalize now with an overview of our TomTech solutions for strain. As you've seen, we have this very nice tool called AutoStrain, which can more or less automatically do this strain quantification based on three apical planes, two chamber, three chamber, four chamber, and can do that very quick and reproducible, as well as our routine-based package for 3D-based strain LV function. And then we have a group of software products for more research-oriented and advanced strain quantification, our package called 2D CPA. CPA stands for cardiac performance analysis. And with this package, you are very flexible to measure all kinds of strain, global and regional, and free wall strain, and every strain you like to measure, as well like our 3D solution for the LV analysis and for the RV function, which is then measuring all the global and regional strain parameters for the left ventricle and the septal and free wall strain for the right ventricle with our RV package. And then we have a strain package for cardiac MRI for 2D DICOM clips, where we can more or less do the same quantification we do in 2D echo, but as well on MRI clips, and this is very nicely to compare patients acquired with different modalities. So my summary is really that 2D strain is very robust, easy to generate, and it's a reproducible clinical parameter. And I hope you have seen that it's feasible easily to apply it in the clinical practice, accurate, and it has a high predictive value in the clinical setting. So I believe it will play an important role in serial assessment, especially in cardio-oncology, as shown before. And so it will enter routine more and more, and solutions like our AutoStrain, what we call the vendor-neutral solutions, will help to reduce the vendor differences, because then it can be the strain can be calculated independently from a GE, Philips, Siemens, or Toshiba system, all with the same software package, and this is reducing the differences. And 3D strain, last but not least, it can as well be done very easily and quick. And right now, it's not so much in the clinical routine, but I believe it will have a really great future potential. With that, I'd like to conclude and thank you very much for your attention. And as you know, you can now put questions in your question window, and then we will read the question and try to answer them. You can as well always send us questions by email later on. And with that, I would like to give back to Doug, and Doug will then coordinate the question-answer session.
Thank you, Bernard, for the very informative webinar. And as Bernard mentioned, we do have a question session open now, and I will read your questions.
So, Doug, I already see one question here. I will read it. Mm-hmm. The question is, I think that the phantom test does not reproduce the variability in the quality of the echocardiography images related to the sonographic features of each patient. Yes and no. We know that the synthetic data are just a first step, and the Leuven group is just working on an improved synthetic data set where the sonographic features are much more programmed into the phantom, and that the phantom really looks like a real heart. However, we know it will not always be completely the same, and that's why we go both ways, the phantom tests and in parallel real patients and volunteers and the real world, the clinical world. So both has been done, but up to now the results are very promising and show that more or less we have quite identical findings in the phantom as well as in the real world with patients. An example, if the heartbeat rate goes up to 150 beats per second, then all the vendors, there's a much higher variability because of the frame rate issue, and things like that can be nicely proven with this dynamic phantom. So I hope this could answer the first question. Then we have a second question here. Are there any certain standards like frame rate, etc., to achieve the strained images? Yes, so we know that the temporal resolution plays a role, and it needs to be in line with the heartbeat. So if you have a rest heartbeat of 60 beats per second, probably your strain measurements are good. If you acquire with 40 frames per second, it's enough. It will not be enough if you have an exercise stress patient in a heartbeat of 150 beats per minute. Then probably you should go up to 80 to 100 frames per second with your 2D frame rate of the ultrasound system. So to be on the safe side, the tests which have been done in with the phantoms have been with a frame rate between 50 and 90 frames per second. So that's where all the tests have been made based on the phantom tests today. So it seems that no more questions are coming, at least up to now. So Doug, as always, now we have another question here. The paper I mentioned in Czech for prognostic values find a similar correlation or any predictive value worth quoting. You mean the prognostic value, the Czech paper here. You mean the similar correlation between the vendors? So it was done, so in this paper it was done with two-dimensional speckle tracking and three-dimensional speckle tracking, and they compared longitudinal, circumferential, and radial, as well as global 3D strain for every patient. But they've done it always with the TomTech software, and for some of the patients they had MRI and compared it then as well with our 2D speckle tracking for MRI in order to look at the correlation, but as I recall the paper, it was not a inter-vendor correlation. It was more to look at this, what is the best parameter in terms of 2D, 3D spectral tracking to assess this outcome of asymptomatic patients. Now we got another question. How do you explain to sonographers how to adjust the frame rate? So I would say it's very easy, as higher as better. That's a kind of ground rule. But we know if you go to higher frame rate, probably you have other limitations you need to limit your sector width. So you should be okay if for normal patients without stress to scan with 50 frames per second. But always try to have the highest frame rate between 50 and 100, and then you should be on the safe side.
Okay, everyone, this now concludes our webinar at this time. As previously mentioned by Bernhard, you can submit questions post-webinar to our site, and we will be more than happy to get back with you at this time. So once again, thank you, everyone, for joining us. Bernhard, thank you as well, and see you next time on TomTech Academy.
Yeah, and thanks everybody for listening. We know that it's very late or early morning already in the Far East, and have a nice day in on the west side of this Earth. Thank you.